Signore e signori, buonasera, benvenuti alla Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò della New York University. We are delighted to have a chance to present Terence Ward's new book, The Guardian of Mercy. And here is a copy of the book. I remind you that we also have copies of the book upstairs for sale, and you are welcome to purchase your own copy, and Terence will sign it for you at the end of the presentation. I think I followed this project of Terence since the very beginning. I've been a good friend, and I'm privileged to be a good friend of Terence and Idana Pucci for many years, and they spend part of the year in New York, and we always get together, and normally something comes out of our random meetings. And that was quite a long time ago, and I remember the first time they came back after that experience, how vivid the experience of entering into this chapel, the chapel of the Pio Monte di Misericordia, that is a sort of a pawn shop for poor people in Naples, and then we'll delve into it into more details. And how in that first meeting where Terence told me about this experience, the experience of seeing this painting and the experience of meeting a person were combined and intertwined. So in Terence Ward's book, you have these double experience. The experience of looking at art and understanding art, or trying to understand art. And at the same time, you have the experience of getting to know people. Specifically, this person in Naples that becomes a sort of a metaphor of the whole town. And I don't want to give away too much, but is the title of the book comes from the person that is paid by the city to keep the church open and to keep an eye on it that nothing bad happens. And it was a project started by the Basolino administration. And basically, people who were already employed by the city were redirected into this kind of work. And Angelo Esposito, that is somehow the protagonist with Terence and Didanna of the book, and Caravaggio, used to work and worked for about 25 years in the sewage system of Naples. So for him, the idea of being rescued from the sewage and being brought to spend his days in front of Caravaggio was really a life-changing experience. And after the first moment in which he was not sure about what to do, he gets really enthralled into this experience, into this viewing experience. And I don't want to say too much about this painting. It's one of my favorite paintings. I have never had the chance to see it in real life. I've been to Naples many, many times. I was not fortunate enough to be there when Angelo Esposito were opening the Piemonte and showing the painting. It has always puzzled me. And lately, over Christmas break, knowing that I was to present Terence's book, I did a little experiment with my family. We were gathered for St. Stephen, that is my patron saint, and at some point I was discussing something that we're going to show in a few seconds, that is the logo chosen by the Holy See for the extraordinary Jubilee of Mercy that we are celebrating right now in the Catholic world. And then vis-a-vis that one, I showed this painting, and I wanted to hear the reaction of my family, young and old, men and women and so on. And nobody is indifferent to this painting. It captures you, it attracts you in, it invites you to enter into the dynamic of this street alley in Naples, where with all these cast of characters that are very hard to identify. So it's a fascinating representation. We know the title, it's The Seven Works of Mercy. And Pelle and Terence are gonna get into more detail into it. The narrative that you have in Terence Ward's book is basically a parallel story. There is the story of Caravaggio, and especially of the last few years in his life, after the fattaccio, when he is involved in a murder in Rome, he's accused of murdering somebody, and he is condemned to death by the papal administration, and he leaves. And whereas everybody expects him to go north, where he's from, he goes south. And in Naples, he finds a new life, as it very often happens to people who visit Naples. And it finds this exciting environment, this life beyond belief, and a safe haven. He's welcomed by the local aristocracy, and especially by this group of people that are responsible for the Piemonte, that are the people that run this organization, charitable institution, with seven governors, one for each of the works of mercy that we're going to see in a minute. And they give him this beautiful commission to complete the pala d'altare, the altarpiece for the main chapel. It's an octagonal chapel. The main altar, as this is an altarpiece, and then in each of the other chapels there is the representation of one of the seven works of corporal mercy. To give you some sort of background, and this is what I'm going to say about the book and about Caravaggio, I want to step back just briefly, just to give you a little context. So try to keep in mind this painting, how complicated, intricate, difficult to understand it is. One of the things that people try to do is identify the works of mercy here, but do not ask that question to Terence Ward, because he wrote a book about it. And the idea is that getting to understand who is doing what and who are these characters is exactly the experience that Caravaggio is inviting you to do. Now, we're going to step back about 400 years, four centuries before, just to give you a representation, an idea of how the same theme could be dealt with in a completely different way. Julian, thank you. So we moved a few hundred kilometers north. I'm sorry, but this is around where I live. That's Parma. That's a beautiful Piazza del Duomo. And you see there is this complex. There is the cathedral, very simple, very austere Romanesque building with the bell tower and the baptistry. So now we'll concentrate on the baptistry, 11th century, by architect and sculptor Benedetto Antelami. And this is the main portal. This is the west portal, or Portale del Redentore. And I remember when I used to go to the University of Parma, this was all gray. So we thought that it was a gray building. Then it was clean, and it was this bright pink. And of course, people were not very satisfied, but that's what it was. All of a sudden, it looked like a candy box appeared in the middle of the square. It's a fantastic candy box, if you ask me. But the most incredible thing is that also the pigments for the coloration of the marble appeared. So you see the central lunette. It's all colored. It's an alto rilievo, high relief, and painted on marble. And the pigments resisted through the centuries and the incrustations of dirt that for centuries covered it. Now, we are going to concentrate on the left lesena to the door. And you see that there are how many pieces here? Six. And that's another mystery that Terence addresses. When Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew basically enunciates and pronounces the works of corporal mercy, I was hungry and you gave me food, I was thirsty and you gave me water, and so on and so forth, there's six. And all of a sudden, we all know that the works of mercy are seven. There is a seventh one that is not mentioned by Jesus, and you will have to tell me what it is, but after, when you talk to Terence. Here it does not appear. It is a very faithful rendition of the six works of corporal mercy according to Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. They're beautiful high reliefs, as you can see. They're all into each of them into its own frame. It's a perfect frame, you see, with two windows. This is dar da bere agli assetati, give drinks of water to the thirsty. And this is welcoming the pilgrim, or curing the sick. You see that the person here, there is a person dressed in a very rich robe garment, and then there is somebody with a stick, with a cane, probably a sick person. So this is a very Romanesque, pre-Gothic way of addressing the issue of the works of mercy. Make it very clear. Make it simple. each work of mercy a little square, and it has to be immediately understood by everybody. So if you want to go to salvation, if you want to be eventually saved by Jesus, that remember is on the top, on the lunette of the portale, you better do these six things. This is what is going to get you there. So it's a very simple, very immediate form of religious communication. If you want to have access to salvation, performing the works of mercy is what is going to get you there. And that's in the words of Jesus. So you saw Caravaggio did something completely different. There are no squares. There are no like comic squares or book or little separations or divisions. How many characters are in the painting?
16.
16 characters. And don't be fooled. Some characters perform two works of mercy at the same time. And some of them, not even one. So do not look for one character, one act of mercy. It's a much more complicated. And just look at the dynamic going up there. The two angels, are they fighting? Are they hugging? And look at that very unusual baby Jesus in the arms of the Virgin Mary. So you saw in 400 years the differences in the representation of the works of mercy. And how different this is. This is a scene of life in the streets of Naples that Caravaggio presents. And on so many layers and so many levels of depth that Terence investigated, and he leads you through it in his book. Now, just to close my remarks, a little comic relief. And as a Catholic, I'm not very happy to present this as comic relief, but I think we have to. Julian? Okay, this ugly image is the logo chosen for the International Year of Mercy that is being celebrated by the Catholic Church right now. At first, I really couldn't make what it was about. I thought it's a Good Shepherd, but that yellow thing on top of that other man is not a sheep, it's another man. So it's very difficult to understand what it is, first of all. So it lacks the immediacy of the works of mercy that you saw in Antelami, that you could clearly understand without any doubt what it was. So it's a very difficult subject. And after some research, I discovered that Jesus is not on skis, as it could seem right there. And we know that he's Jesus because he has the halo with the cross, and he has the stigmata in both his feet and his hands. And it's a representation of Jesus rescuing Adam from hell. So very hard to understand that. The other thing that puzzled me is, how many eyes does Jesus have? Is it three, one? Does he share an eye with Adam? Does he see eye to eye with Adam? And when I at this point, I really had it, because comparing the works of mercy of Caravaggio with this thing, it says something about a decline, at least in the taste of humanity. And when I did my further research, I went to see where this horrible thing comes from. And it comes from a convent of Ursuline nuns in Verona. And it's a representation, as I said, of Jesus rescuing Adam from hell. And if you take some time to look it up online, you will see that in the original version, there is an Eve hanging from Adam's arm, trying to be rescued as well. They don't seem too concerned about taking Eve out of hell. So simply, the designer of the logo cleaned up, photoshopped Eve out, and we are left with this. It's a testament to the change in taste. I think, for example, that it doesn't particularly speak about the value of mercy, what mercy is. Whereas I think, of course, the Caravaggio painting could not be chosen as an icon or a logo, hardly a logo, with all this stuff going on. But I think that some brilliant designer could have come up isolating maybe a detail, and I'll leave it to you to decide which one, of this painting, and to be used in this celebration of the Year of Mercy. We have to say that the Book of Terence comes out during the Year of Mercy, and there is some sort of providential design, because at some point, Terence had his computer stolen, with his backup stolen, but the whole book was already written, more or less the whole thing. And after serious consideration and after much of Idanna's encouragement, he decided to rewrite it. Wow. And il caso, or providence, ha voluto that the publication of the book coincides with the jubilee, the special jubilee of mercy proclaimed by Pope Francis. Then when we gather after Pelle's remark and after Terence's reading, I'll have a couple of questions for Terence. And now it's with great pleasure that I would like to introduce you to my colleague and friend, Pellegrino da Cerno. Pellegrino is a professor of comparative literature at Hofstra University. He has taught at NYU, Columbia University, many other places. I would say if I have to pinpoint somebody that really strived throughout his whole career to put Italian studies and Italian literature on the map of major American intellectual life is Pellegrino da Cerno. We were very happy and proud to have him as the first holder of the Tirosegno Professorship in Italian-American Studies here at New York University. Pelle's interests range from cinema studies to literature to architecture and the study of space. He's a big fan of Naples. He organized a conference at Hofstra and here at the Casa, Delirious Naples, very successful. And therefore, we thought there couldn't be anybody else as Pelle that could present this book. Let alone the fact that during our meeting with Idanna, and please, Idanna put your seat here on the floor.
No,
and, and she's one of the main protagonists of the book. Right here. So when we met this past summer at Idanna's residence in Florence, she asked me, have you ever heard of a professor called Pellegrino da Cerno? I said, yes, he's a good friend. We do things together. And that's where the thing was born. We combined the presentation of Terence's new book with this reconnection between, and we're not going to say an old professor, but a very distinguished professor and a very promising student that was Idanna at Columbia when she met Pellegrino. So without further ado, please welcome Pellegrino da Cerno.
I've spent my whole life avoiding being a scripted person, but I find myself, I find it necessary to read a text to you, because I wanted to get certain things right about Terry's writing and his relationship to Caravaggio. And it's a way, the reading of a written text is a way of praising Terry. And praise, as you know, is the verbal form of love. So this is essentially a love letter. I'm thrilled and honored to be here to celebrate the publication of Terence Ward's ecstatic and soul-searching, or dare I say, mystical by way of its humanism, new book, The Guardian of Mercy. Its theme is set out in the subtitle, How an Extraordinary Painting by Caravaggio Changed an Ordinary Life Today. The ordinary life is that of a humble Neapolitan named Angelo Esposito, who serves as the guardian of Caravaggio's The Seven Acts of Mercy, perhaps the artist's greatest and most astonishing and dramatic painting. Angelo will also serve as Terry's ad hoc mentor in comprehending both the extraordinary enigmas Caravaggio has embedded within his masterpiece and those other ordinary enigmas, be they merciful or unmerciful, that life obliges us to confront. The book is full of grace. That is to say, it is written with grace, with almost every striking sentence imparting an epiphany. And more comprehensively, its double narrative is an exercise in grace, that duplicates the grace that Caravaggio embedded in his gaze-boggling capolavoro, the Seven Acts of Mercy, that serves as the altarpiece for the Church of Piemonte della Misericordia in Naples. Caravaggio, as a painter, is an angel of violence. And in the painting, that violence is expressed formally by the folding of the vertical into the horizontal, by the folding of light into darkness to create the infinity of chiaroscuro, by the folding of the chaos of 16 figures into the order of the seven acts of mercy, by the folding of the sacred into the profane, by which the ordinariness and materiality of the profane is sacralized. Caravaggio's religious paintings, above all the seven acts of mercy, require their viewers to be necessary angels in the sense elaborated by Wallace Stevens. Yet I am the necessary angel of earth, since in my sight you see the earth again. In the seven acts of mercy, we see the earth in the faces, gazes, and bodies of the Neapolitan street people that Caravaggio used as models and transformed into compassionate, erratic figures. And Terry's double text also requires its readers to be necessary angels, through which we bear witness to acts of mercy in both the painting and present-day reality, and by which we experience through our empathy as viewers slash readers the grace that Caravaggio embedded in his painting. Within the main narrative of the ordinary but troubled life of the guardian or keeper of Caravaggio's masterpiece, Terry folds the counter-narrative of the Neapolitan episode of Caravaggio's extraordinary and troubled life and his creation of the painting that was grounded in his experience of Neapolitan street life, the Lazzaroni and Scugnizzi of Spaccanapoli, serving as models for the 16 figures that collide in an astonishing montage that not only defined the Baroque and its spectacle culture, but would open the way to the aesthetics of shock that come to define modernism. Terry begins his book with these words, "I did not seek out the story, this story found me." He then goes on to describe his chance meeting at the Church of Piemonte with Angelo, who cries out to Adana and him, "Non andate via, don't leave, listen." Jung would describe this as an instance of synchronicity, as a meaningful coincidence. Before continuing, I want to be personal for a moment and explain the synchronicity at work in the events leading me here tonight. You see, Adana Pucci, there she is. Terry's beloved wife, who figures prominently in the book's main narrative, was my student at Columbia in the good old days. I should add, my most brilliant student of all time. We fell out of touch over the years, but somehow my name came up in a conversation with Stefano Albertini, and I was unexpectedly invited to participate in this event. This instance of synchronicity has led me to Terry and the reading of his electrifying book on Caravaggio, in which he also stages a powerful encounter with old and contemporary Naples. This involved two more instances of synchronicity pertaining to my own writing. I am now completing the introduction to a forthcoming book titled Delirious Naples, as Stefano mentioned, and also engaged in writing a poem on Caravaggio for my new book of poems, 13 Ways of Crossing the Piazza, which are set in Rome's Piazza Navona. The poem is titled Reality as a Triptych by Caravaggio, and treats Caravaggio's triptych dedicated to St. Matthew in the Church of San Luigi dei Francesi in Rome. Terry's book has been a blessing to me, and I want to express my wild gratitude to him for the electrifying experience of reading it. It has inspired both of these projects, making me love Caravaggio even more, if that is possible, and illuminating my understanding of Neapolitan culture. And how much time? I have a bit more time. what I did was, in encountering the book, I wrote seven reasons for reading Terence Ward's The Guardian of Mercy, okay? I'm not at all a commercial person, okay? But as Terry points out, 7 is the sacred number for Caravaggio's painting and for almost everything else of significance in the universe. So there need to be 7 reasons, okay? And I'm just going to more or less enumerate them, and I may read one in detail, okay? But I'm determined not to divulge any spoilers. Terry would Caravaggio me. Okay, the first is to experience the Caravaggio effect, the adrenaline rush that Caravaggio imparts to the spectator as he or she views the 7 acts of mercy, whether for the first or last time. Terry describes his first encounter with the dynamic force of the painting and the hold of its uncanniness exerts upon him. Terry speaks. My gaze slowly rises to the grand painting above the dimly lit altar. I step closer, drawn in by the eerie chiaroscuro, which figures so lifelike. I've never seen a painting like this. Startling, magnetic, strange. And throughout the double narrative, Terry positions the reader as viewer in the point of view of both Caravaggio and the guardian Angelo Esposito, the latter having familiarized his gaze with the painting by seeing it through Neapolitan eyes as a spectacle of the street life of Spaccanopoli, and by micro-focusing in on all those elements and figures that Caravaggio conceals or partially erases in the painting. As Angelo says, no painter can be compared to Caravaggio, not even Leonardo. At least this is what I think. But if you want to go deeper, you have to look for the symbols. You have to use biblical and classical eyes. I would add Hitchcock's gaze, okay? But it is through the Neapolitan gaze, the ordinary gaze of the Neapolitan street people, those who are traditionally negated and rendered invisible, that Angelo takes possession of the painting and its enigmas, and in turn is possessed by it. As he puts it, now Caravaggio is flowing in my veins. And it is this Caravaggio effect that Terry and Adana, and by extension the reader as viewer, are led to experience. As we read, Caravaggio flows in our veins. Okay? So that's the first effect. And then the first reason. The second reason is to read otherwise. That is to read through sliding doors. The metaphor borrowed from Richard Seaver that Terry uses to describe his bold experiment in doubling his narrative. Okay, it's already been discussed, so I'm going to skip the details of the double narrative. 3, to view, read Caravaggio otherwise. As does Caravaggio, Terry, under the tutelage of the guardian, challenges his reader, or more precisely, the reader as viewer, to do gaze work and face-to-face work, by which the epiphany of a face is recognized as a visitation. By so doing, he creates another way of doing art history. He positions us to view the altarpiece through the gazes of both Caravaggio and the guardian. Take, for example, the episode of the so-called Caritas Romana, the exemplary story of a woman, Pero, who secretly breastfeeds her father, Simon, after he is incarcerated and sentenced to death by starvation. She is found out by a jailer, but her act of selflessness impresses officials and wins her father's release. Here Caravaggio transforms Roman pietas into the 2 Christian corporal works of mercy, visiting prisoners and feeding the hungry. By spotlighting Pero, Caravaggio makes her apprehensive gaze toward the invisible jailers propel the viewer to the center and right side of the painting. Through a flashback, Terry first positions us in Caravaggio's refined and aesthetic point of view. As he writes, through her eyes, Caravaggio knows viewers will enter the painting. The glow on her breast will seize their attention. They will feel her risk and uncertain fate. Meanwhile, her father will continue to suckle her milk, oblivious to swordsmen, torches, beggars, travelers, and the nameless corpse amid the swarming spectacle. Later on, he will position us in Angelo's down-to-earth point of view. In ancient Rome, there was a young woman called Pero. One day, her father was arrested for some reason. I don't remember. Well, she goes to his rescue and keeps him alive. Look closely. She's afraid that somebody may see her, but her papa is so famished that he has even spilled 2 drops of milk. That requires micro-focusing. What she fears most are the prison guards, but when the guards come out, they will be so moved by her daring that they'll open the prison doors. Her father will walk out a free man. Caravaggio always shocks us, pushing us beyond taboos. And Angelo's exegesis of the painting culminates with these words. In the end, his art isn't about bishops in silk robes giving handouts to the needy. It's about simple people helping one another. He's the artist of the poor, our artist. There's no one else like him. This doubling of gazes is certainly a way of doing art history in another way, and I would argue in a more effective, empathetic, and fault-felt way. Art historians tend to argue incessantly over whether Caravaggio is either a realist or a populist. Angelo and Terry argue that he's a realist because he is a populist whose realism endows the proletariat with a face and body that is their own. The fourth reason is to learn from Naples. Terry stages a profound cultural encounter with Naples, as framed by his contemporary understanding of Italy. In this encounter with delirious Naples, as I like to call it, he never loses his nerve and becomes much more than a cultural or intellectual tourist. He encounters the city of obstructed meanings in a plenary way that confronts the contradictions and aporias that Naples presents. I'm going to skip the next part and jump to the fifth reason, and that is to learn from Caravaggio and to get Caravaggio right. As Patrice Marandel has written, admired by his contemporaries, Caravaggio has now become a universal figure, as popular as a rock star, his reputation edging out that of Michelangelo or Leonardo. This may be the case, but I wonder if Caravaggio has been completely humanized and destigmatized. Despite all the biographies and films, even a ballet and a performance piece in the form of tableaux vivants, recently dedicated to him and are part of the postmodernist retrieval of his work and legacy. In Derek Jarman's 1986 film dedicated to Caravaggio, one of the characters shouts out, "They said people can't pray in front of a killer's paintings." As the other scripture, the negative one begun in 1672 by Bellori in his Lives of the Painters, has it, Caravaggio was a maestro of recklessness and transgression, a wicked man, according to Stendhal, a black Michelangelo, more a murderer than a saint. The great gift of Terry's book is to humanize Caravaggio by endowing him with interiority and by recognizing the empathy and lessons in mercy at work in the seven acts of mercy, which can be regarded as Caravaggio's own solicitation of mercy for his transgressions. The guardian Angelo puts it this way: why can't they see Caravaggio as a poet of hope? He implores, speaking now like a poet himself. And this is exactly how Terry's book views Caravaggio. The real murders Caravaggio perpetrated were in the distortions of his paintings that wreaked havoc on the regulative mapping aesthetics of Renaissance classicism, and more important, by which the profane was rendered sacred, the boundaries between the earthly world and the heavenly realm obliterated, and the invisible and defaced bodies of the lower class made visible in a way that disrupts and overturns the class gaze of those papal and patrician patrons who feted him nonetheless. Caravaggio is the prophet of the plebs, who annihilates the gaze of his spectators, and his true art of terribilità lies in getting rid of the traces of these gaze murders, erasing them in the tenebroso and the sacred violence of light. Caravaggio's great lessons. Light may be only accessed through darkness. Grace only comes through violence. Okay, six, to comprehend the genealogy of the seven corporal acts of mercy. And here I would just say that Terry's drawing of that genealogy culminates in Pope Francis. And another instance of synchronicity, the title of Pope Francis's new book is The Name of God is Mercy. Okay? Pope Francis is a Caravaggio. Okay? And then the seventh reason, to be challenged to undertake soul work, even if one is a secular reader. Here I refer to reading as an act of empathy. To do soul work is to do face work by which the other is endowed with a face. And here I shall remain silent, leaving the soul work for you to determine as Terry's potential readers, who will inevitably read the book with passion and compassion, thereby becoming necessary angels. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pelle, for these brilliant, very thorough, and very deep reflection on Terence's book. I really enjoyed it tremendously. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce you to the author of the book we are presenting tonight. Terence Ward is a writer, producer, and cross-cultural consultant in the Middle East. For more than 25 years, he has advised companies, foundations, and governments. He's originally from Boulder, Colorado. He lives between New York, Florence, and many other parts of the world. I just want to mention his first book, Searching for a Son, A Journey to the Heart of Iran, a country in which Terence spent the formative years of his youth. And the book is about a trip he undertook about 30 years after he had left. The book was saluted as a great success, and on the back of this book, you will have some of the blurbs that came out for Searching for a Son. He also has produced films, documentaries, and with his wife, Idanna, they are a traveling cultural center. They are always so generous with their ideas, with their proposals, and with the making of them. It's really a pleasure to see them working together on so many projects and opening up these projects to their friends and to the people like us who have the fortune of being involved. Please welcome Terence Ward.
No, I can't. There are moments in life where words fail. But let me say that it's such a rich and warm and intimate feeling to be here at Casa Italiana with Stefano and with all of you, many friends, and of course Caravaggio lovers. And Pelle's words that really left me speechless. The intensity and the depth with which he understood what I was hoping to do, I could not express. So that's an extraordinary feeling. The other thing I wanted to share with you is that as much as we've looked at this question of the painter and this painting, which many have never seen on the road because it never leaves Naples. So if you want to see it, you must go there. In fact, when it was first commissioned 400 years ago, and I'll share a small reason why, one of the stipulations that the founders inscribed, they were so stunned with the work, they understood what they were seeing. but so stunned that they immediately stipulated it could never leave the premises. Because, as you know, ownership of property is 90% whoever has it at the time. Knowing full well, it probably never would come back. So this is a work that if you really want to see it, you must go there. And I was also a bit surprised to see how many in the room actually had raised their hand and said that they had made that journey. But I think Pelle and both Stefano and Pelle really touched on the visceral, or say the direct sense that I wanted to share. If you have to go there, then what is that feeling like? And tonight, I wanted to share with those of you who haven't had that chance, the broader idea of what a gift of life, an astonishing surprise, can be. When a person, a story, reaches out and grabs you, when you, of course you have to be ready for it, but then you also have to be willing to enter into another world. In this case, it was the heart of Naples, as Pelle and Stefano have mentioned, Napoli, as we know of it, a world of chiaroscuro, light and dark. And with my infinitely better half, Idanna, as my guide, that door of the hermetic world of Naples opened. Also, as Pelle mentioned, Richard Seaver was an extraordinary help. This legendary publisher who founded Arcade with his wife, Jeanette, a number of years ago. And it was he that suggested this idea of the Japanese sliding doors. Those of you who have read Calvino and read his classic Città Invisibile, Invisible Cities, remember how there was always this thrust of Marco Polo sitting with Kublai Khan discussing this world that lay beyond, and then this shift. And you went and saw each of those cities as they were narrated. Only at the end did you discover they were all Venice, which only Venetians can do. But this idea of using these sliding doors allowed to narrate the story between past and present, but always in the present. And to travel between this gap of 400 years. And then there was this other friend, Michael Ondaggi, who had come to Florence to give a lectio magistralis at the Palazzo Medici Ricciardi. And on that balmy June day, he surprised everybody because, of course, Florence is rather classical and very, very rigid and very firm. And he started to speak about his work, and he referred to it as mongrel art, to which everybody stared at him because, of course, mongrel being what we know, a questionable parentage. Well, what he defined was something quite different. He said it's art that reaches across the divide, art that draws inspiration over the waters, art that it draws associations beyond one's culture. And so he mapped out how this art moves between various forms. And he gave a number of examples. One that was rather surreal, he said Isadora Duncan was filmed. That film traveled to Sri Lanka. A Sri Lankese dancer saw it and changed classical Sri Lankan dancing forever. So, between one ocean, another, on a different medium, and then a whole tradition changes, and a different art form. So he described how art can move between forms, painting into literature, into film, from music to writing. And I think of this book, also along with that earlier book that I wrote on Iran, as following spontaneously into this mongrel genre. And strangely enough, both Iran and Naples have a little PR problem, if you know what I mean. benighted may be another way of describing the two settings. And then a surprise visitor arrived in Florence, Pete Hamill, who, those of you who remember the old days when the New York Post was actually a liberal newspaper, and he was the champion editor at the time. Well, he was on to Sicily to research a book focused on a stolen Caravaggio, the Caravaggio that was stolen by the mafia. And he read my original manuscript, and he encouraged me to do a deeper description of a fella he called Mr. C. You see, Terry, Mr. C, you know, you gotta get into his oils, into his pigments. You gotta, that radical light, you know, you gotta show him polishing it. He said, be up front. So I did. I wrote, and you'll see it in the author's notes, I'm not an art historian. He said, that's the best way to cover yourself in this politically murky world of art, especially all those Caravaggisti out there that'll be gunning for you. And then, of course, I can't ever express the love and affection and the inspiration that Idanna, my wife, has shared with me. And she, having Neapolitan blood, was drawn to this city with a passion, with compassion. And when I was still, shall I say, learning Italian, it wasn't as good as it is now. She also, there are some people who can read signs. And in Naples, if you can't read the signs, you're finished. And they sometimes aren't visible. It's a feeling, it's a mood, it's a decision to cross the street or not cross the street. It's a scene where Angelo walks with her and he says, no, cara mia, you walk on this side and hold your purse there, because along the street, the Vespas drive. And that elegant way of being a gentiluomo isn't just about being gentiluomo. C'è qualcosa, no? Ecco, you always... So all of these signs, for those of us who have it, if you don't have the radar, you don't have the radar, right? So Idanna really opened the door and helped lead me and the story in. And you'll see that actually the story in the end is a tribute to her compassion, because this painting does not simply change the life of an ordinary Neapolitan. It saves his life, and she has a huge role to play in that. And the other person I wanted to give a warm salute to is also Duff Lambros, who years before, I had met her here in New York, and for some strange reason, I started talking about this painting and about Angelo and describing this whole experience. And Duff was very interested, and I had no idea the seed that Angelo had planted in me was now going to be planted in someone else. And Duff, after, of course, 9/11, all of us saw Naples come to New York. All of us saw all the chaos and all the wounded souls and all the loss and confronted death. And at that point, she decided that she was going to pursue her chaplaincy degree so she could counsel, so she could enter into the hospices, so she could help, so she could share mercy. And the thesis with which she wrote to receive that award was on this very painting that you're seeing here. And so from Angelo to a conversation to another to another. And that's what is rather disconcerting about this story, because it has a life. And it's amazing when something touches you and moves you, you are never the same. And precisely what Stefano was saying when he said, look, look at the logo, look at the seven images all out there for you to see in Parma, and look at this. It is not trying to tell you. It is inviting you into that Neapolitan street, into that little alley, that, as Esposito would say, you can find right outside the door now. Go out there. We'll find them. I'll show you these people. And that's the immediacy. And this is one thing that so many art historians forget, is that he is as present and urgent and as alive now, and all of those folks are as alive now as they were when they were painted 400 years ago, with Hollywood lighting. And a dear friend whose name is Walter Murch, who's the great editor of the films that you know, Apocalypse Now, English Patient, has won countless awards. He told me, he said, listen, it's very simple. The inspiration for the lighting that you saw in The Godfather and a host of other films that came after that began here. So, get back to mongrel art. From a painter 400 years ago that influences how the lighting is portrayed in the late 20th century. Scorsese says Mean Streets is simply, Caravaggio in New York, and claims that Last Temptation of Christ was absolutely based on or inspired by Caravaggio's lighting. So again, how... when we're in this world of intermixing, the one thing academia does not like to do is to have interdisciplinary linkages. But with this painter, with this genius, that's all you can do, is make those connections today. So let me just reiterate one last thing. When I did lose the manuscript after I had talked to Duff, and when I did have it stolen late one night, dark and stormy night, and I woke up at 2 a.m, went in, and we were in Indonesia, and I looked, and it was gone. And there is a method to the madness, and had it not been taken then, it would not have come out in this very pregnant time where all the spiritual tectonic plates are shifting, where the most progressive leader on the planet today happens to be the leader of one of the most conservative institutions on the planet, where Pope Francis has absolutely appeared almost, I would even argue, as a bodhisattva, where he becomes the one clear, moral, comforting voice that emerged on the world stage at a moment when insecurity and fear are preeminent, where the only dialogue that most politicians have is that. He takes it a step further, and he speaks with a dramatic compassion and clarity and a collective vision that we have absolutely lost touch with, which is why he strikes such a powerfully deep chord with the believers and the non-believers, with people of every faith. And it is these acts that are the touchstone of his entire message, these acts of mercy. And as Pelle mentioned, his latest book is called The Name of God is Mercy. So, with all that convergence and synchronicity, let me just share a few passages, and I'll begin. The first chapter begins with a quote, Samuel Beckett in The Unnameable. It says, the quote begins, "Where am I? That is the first question." A burst of rain lashes at the window pane. Suddenly I turn to find Idana standing silently behind me. On winter days like this in Florence, a deep melancholy overwhelms her. Her mood changes when the humid chill seeps through our stone walls and settles in. Pushing back her hair, she sighs. My Neapolitan grandmother rarely smiled, but when she was bedridden, all I had to do was utter the word Napoli, and a sudden spark would light up her entire face. Her grandmother was a religious woman, quietly severe, who carried the scars of polio from childhood. Yet she would amuse her grandmother by recounting memories of a Pompeii red villa flooded by magical sunrises when eastern light poured across the great jade bay. You know, in my family, Terenzio, the word Napoli always conjures up light. Let's leave for Naples right away, she exclaims. And that's what we did. Our long journey comes to an end on a corniche that hugs the sea cliffs of Paola Carolla's home in Posillipo. An old friend of Idanna, she welcomes us into her home, filled with bohemian sensibility. Now in her seventh decade, she still exudes a magnetism that is the touchstone of all the muses. Her admirers include a collection of writers and artists: Arthur Kessler, Grigor van Rizzori, Alberto Giacometti, whose bust of Paola stands on the bureau in her salon. Paola first discovered her bohemian side in Paris after she divorced her Armenian husband, a great art collector. She then enrolled at the Sorbonne to enter the field of unconscious with the Freudian disciple Philippe Lacan. Much later, she returned to her native city, where she still practices as a psychoanalyst. Neapolitans are deeply superstitious, she confesses. They don't greet psychology with the open mind of, say, New Yorkers, where it is worn with a badge of honor. Next morning, Assunta, in her sky blue apron, brings to the breakfast table a pitcher of warm milk to add to our brewed espresso steaming in porcelain cups. Light illuminates the dining room that faces the rippling Great Bay. Vesuvio's twin towers, your twin craters, lift high above delicate nestling clouds. The Grand Marine Arc stretches from our host's terrace to the far cliffs of Sorrento. Today, I will show you una maraviglia, Paola purrs, tasting each syllable, a true wonder, she says. You must see the Caravaggio. But remember, she says sternly, leave your valuables behind. Carry nothing, nothing. So we dutifully prepare. I assist her in the ritual of closing every window while Assunta bolts the shutters. Slowly darkness swallows room after room. The illuminated outside world retreats completely. Then she sets the alarm. We leave behind one face of Naples and descend into another. A half hour later, we're navigating through the dense crowd in a jumbled forest of once proud palaces and time-worn tenements. Along a stretch of broken pavement, we step into a tiny piazza with the forlorn church known as the Piemonte della Misericordia, the pious mountain of mercy. A gape-toothed woman beams a smile behind her makeshift table, hawking cigarettes. A speeding Vespa maneuvers around me and scrapes at my ankles. I hurriedly follow Paola inside the church, and as the wooden door closes behind us, the bedlam subsides, a quiet hush. Before us, a tiny wooden sign. It reads, Le sette opere della misericordia, the seven acts of mercy. My eyes rise to the great painting above the dimly lit altar. I step in closer, drawn in by the eerie chiaroscuro, with figures so lifelike. I've never seen any painting like this. Startling, magnetic, strange. Costumed men grapple in the darkness. Who are they? Someone holds a torch. A pair of dirty feet slip out from under his sheet. A sword, blade, it flashes. What's happening here? I turn to Paola, but she offers no explanation. Instead, she sits content on a scarlet cushioned chair, delighted that she's offered us this unfathomable painting. After lingering for a while, Idanna turns to leave. I do the same. Paola rises too. Suddenly, a voice behind us echoes off the walls. Ma che fate? What are you doing? A thin man with silver hair and blazing eyes moves towards us through shadow and light. Ascoltate, listen, non andate via, don't leave, the voice cries out. Now let's travel back 400 years. Staring back through the blurred lens of time, a lonely figure paces towards us on this warm May evening on the banks of the Tiber. Over his shoulders hangs a fashionable black cape. At his hip glistens a razor-sharp rapier. Like most artists in Rome, these days he carries a weapon. It's only natural. Knights in the holy city are fearsome. Brawls and swordplay erupt as if by clockwork. Painters from rival factions don't argue about their styles in cafes. They cross swords in bloody duels and pitched battles. As he approaches, his eyes scan left, right. Look closely at that trim beard, piercing eyes, his unkempt hair. They call him Michelangelo Merisi. Later generations will remember him as Caravaggio, a small town 40 miles east of Milan. Like the maestro from Vinci, he will be forever known by his place of birth. So now back to the Guardian today. You've already heard about the origins of how Angelo was found or brought by the mayor in this cycle of trying to open up the churches and turn them into museums. Idanna is about to ask Angelo the pregnant question. She says, "And what did you feel at the beginning?" Idanna asks. Angelo replies, "I'll be frank. I really didn't care where I was. None of us did. It was just a job. I didn't give a damn about what was on the walls. Culture is a luxury for the poor. I spent all my time playing cards with my colleagues and chatting, sneaking out for a coffee, just killing time between one occasional visitor and the other. The authorities, they tried to make us learn what to say. And I just repeated word for word without any idea of what I was saying. Così. But when did it change? Say, after about a year ago, something began to sink in. I started to like the place. And one day I looked up and over there, I was sitting there." He points to the front pew where he sat on that fateful morning. He'd just opened the church, quietly was waiting there for the first visitors to walk in, but then something reached out and grabbed him, and he felt his eyes being raised to the altarpiece. And there, Idanna, I saw it for the first time. I saw the painting, as if for the first time," he says excitedly. "There on the canvas, I recognized my brothers. I recognized my sisters. It all happened so suddenly, I couldn't believe it. And soon I found myself searching everywhere for clues about Caravaggio's life. I taught myself how to read again," he says, raising his arms. "Now I have Caravaggio flowing in my veins." So at this point, we move back in time again. It's June 1606. And in 1606, Caravaggio has just arrived. Exile is a poem by Pablo Neruda. Exile is round in shape, a circle, a ring. Your feet go in circles. You cross land. It is not your land. Light wakes you up, and it is not your light. Night comes down, but your stars are missing. You discover brothers, and they're not of your blood. Pablo Neruda from Isla Negra. So high above the squalid streets in the so-called piano nobile, or the first floor of many Neapolitan palaces, tongues of pampered aristocrats wag about the latest news. He's staying on Via Chiaia, in Palazzo Carafa Colonna. Did you hear what happened in Rome? Yes, but he's safe with us. Rome's loss is our gain. Gossip trades back and forth. He's here, he's here. The word passes excitedly. News of Caravaggio's arrival in Naples, it quickly spreads among this nobility. Undaunted by his murder charge and death sentence pronounced in Rome, those fascinated by his reputation begin to seek him out. And next I read about the moment when Caravaggio receives the commission of the painting. Please, sit here, maestro. Marquis Sersale motions to Caravaggio. Let me tell you just how we started the Piemonte. Caravaggio obliges and sits down among the seven noblemen. It was a Thursday, the third Thursday of the month, Sersale begins, in the steaming August, one of those days of dolce far niente, doing sweet nothing. We friends gathered in Posillipo by the sea. We laid down our picnic, and suddenly the skies turned dark. Strong winds began to blow. In a matter of seconds, a furious tempest raged across the bay. The crashing waves forced us to take refuge in a grotto. Meanwhile, the deluge lashed the rocks outside, and we huddled together in great fear. When the thunderstorm finally passed, our lives had been spared, and it seemed like a divine sign. Maestro, I rose and I made a proposition. Let us bring our food to the hospital where it's needed. Everybody immediately agreed, and so we bundled up our feast and trekked across town until we reached the hospital of the incurabiles, the incurables. It's a terrifying place. For the rest of the day, we fed the afflicted and comforted the dying. The experience was so intense and rewarding that we decided to meet there again every Thursday. Now, make no mistake, none of us are firstborn. We do not stand to inherit and have little or no patrimony. So little is expected of us. We took turns camouflaging ourselves as beggars, standing out at the entrance of the Duomo and outside our family palaces. I was there first. I concealed my face with a hood over my head. At the end of 30 days, my alms box had 33 cadellini. Rumors began to circulate. Our sisters and mothers recognized us and started to make donations to our cause. Other families followed. Sersale rises to make his pitch to Caravaggio. Maestro, we are the first Brotherhood Charity to receive recognition from the Holy See. Now the acts of mercy are no longer the monopoly of the clergy. It's a groundbreaking moment. We have just finished building our headquarters. It has taken us 4 years. Above the altar, the wall is still barren. We've been waiting for a great artist who will bring luster to our cause. We have been waiting for you. In that moment, Sersale, of course, asked Caravaggio about Matteo or Matthew 25. Many of us in the room don't know what that means, but in those days, there were very few people who did not know what that meant. And as we saw earlier, those were the original six acts of mercy. What Caravaggio does is he adds the seventh, because Naples was a city consumed by plague, famine, eruptions, invasions. And the one thing these young men understood is that until they could break this code and allow even the most humble soul to receive those last rites, there was an injustice that they simply couldn't live with. So part of the funds they raised went to pay priests to be good enough to give last rites to those who had passed in the hospital of the incurables. It may not seem like much now, but they were about as radical as you can imagine. No one from the nobility crossed over to the other side. That was the job of the clergy. So, In a sense, Caravaggio found compatriots in this group of young men. They were probably in their early 20s. And, shall we say, he found common cause. This is the first painting he paints after he runs for his life with a death sentence on his head. And that's why it sings with so much compassion, because it is also his song, seeking that very mercy that all the figures in the painting are seeking. And the Piemonte then becomes the unifying thread between past and present in the story, because it's been going on for 400 years through all of those crises I was describing, and it's thriving today with 1,200 members. And believe it or not, on the board are still 7 governors, also women. And there is always at least one descendant from the original founders. Perhaps this could exist only in Italia, no? Ecco. Now we fast forward to the Guardian today. He says to us, he says, "But now all I want to do is introduce the visitors to this painting. It tells you all you need to know about how to live together with solidarity. In this crazy, violent world, we have no choice. We've got to give a hand to each other. If we don't do that, we're all dead." He takes a deep breath. He says, "Take my friend Giannino at the bar." The Guardian continues, "He could be the same tavern keeper you see in the painting. And what about that tall mason making repairs in the courtyard of Piemonte? Isn't he the spitting image of that man over there holding up the torch? All these scenes, they seem so far from our world, but with Caravaggio, they're taking place now. He holds up a mirror to all of us. He shows us how to be human." And now we go back to the past. Sometime in June 1607, a wind blows from the east. Long oars cut into the frothy sea. Each stroke beats to the cadence of the drum. The galley's wooden prow slices westward into oncoming waves as it chases the setting sun. Salt spray settles on Caravaggio's face. With the sea breeze blowing through his black mane of hair, he feels a sense of relief. Below the deck, slaves groan and chant to the pounding drum. The warship's pace is impressive. Maltese galleys are the fastest in the Mediterranean. Sailing along the cliffs of Capri, the royal capital fades behind him. In the distance, as the galley rises and falls in the waves, his gaze settles on Vesuvius that looms on the horizon. The cone shines blown blood red, lit by the dying rays of the sun. Below in its shadow, the city lies. He takes one last look. He imagines the luminous church where his painting will hang forever. In that moment, in June 1607, he cannot imagine that 400 years later, his art will strike a fateful chord and save the life of a humble man born in the Alley of the Sun, just around the corner from the 7 Acts of Mercy. Thank you.
Originally, I thought Pelle and I would start asking questions, but I think we spoke enough. Pelle did a great job. I mean, I was very, very pleased and impressed. But even if I assume that none of you, or very few of you, have read the book, It's your time. If you have questions or comments for Terence Ward or Pelle or myself, please go ahead. Yes. Giovanna, try to speak up. So the question Giovanna asks is that she knows that Caravaggio very often puts himself in his paintings. Is there a portrait of Caravaggio in this painting?
I mean, the beautiful thing about Caravaggio is he never wrote a single note that we're aware of, and he never made a single design or drawing that we are aware of. So all of it ends up with speculation, which is why some people call it the Caravaggio industry. But I will say that if you look at the painting, there are two possible figures that could well be him. According to Angelo Esposito, you can't see it terribly well, but in fact, the 16th figure is just here. Here you see his fingers held. You see him staring in that direction, in a perfect line towards Pero. He's so moved by her action. He's so moved by her compassion. He's in a moment of grace at this moment. He's learned. He's received that grace. It's beyond his control. And this is one figure that Angelo would suggest is Caravaggio. Another one is the gentleman that you see here. And that figure is Samson. And what has Samson just done? He has finished a battle on the field where he has killed thousands of Philistines. His hands have been covered with blood. And he not only is doing one of the acts of mercy, he's drinking water. So it's water to the thirsty, water from the jawbone of the ass. But there's something else that's happening. After a murder of such, shall we say, quantities, he is also purifying himself. And in that purification and the similarity of the facial structure of Caravaggio, what he's been through, that well could be his own portrait. And what is he asking there? Again, grace, mercy for a death that did take place. It's a very debatable question of what was involved. I don't think it was as light as a tennis game bet. I believe that the woman that had been a model for him for both Santa Caterina of Siena and also the portrait of courtesan was had been abused, and the abuser was her lover at the time. And that is the man that Caravaggio takes out. But I don't believe he intended to kill him. I think it was, anyway. But having said that, he now has a death sentence on his head, and there's nothing more passionate than this. And where is he staring? Up to the light. I mean, he's seeking, so it's not just an act, but perhaps there's something autobiographical in it. What I will say is that in this painting, he couldn't have known it, but he actually prophesizes his end. He will be hungry. He will be thirsty, as he has another 3 years of his life on the run with a countless groups of people that could be after him, from the Knights of Malta to figures within the church, to the family of thugs who lost the son. And so all of these acts of, he ends up, of course, dying without a burial. We have no idea where he died or where he would have been buried. So none of those acts of mercy are ever played out for him. So this is also a very prophetic image.
Thank you. Sir.
Sir, as I study this picture for the last hour and a half, my eye is continuously drawn
yes.
to the one quiet dead center.
Which is?
Part of the picture, the illuminated wall.
Yes.
By the golden torch.
Yes.
With the blue-green vein.
Yes.
Why am I so drawn to that empty space?
When the Buddha received enlightenment, they say he stayed there in the immovable spot. And my suggestion is he knew exactly what he was doing, that this is that moment of transcendence and of illumination. This is the only time you will see a light in a painting of Caravaggio. And it glows there as if to say everything is timely, happening now, and it's timeless. You're looking at the eternal mystery. And to follow through that corridor is to pass through the threshold. And why the light? Because the figure underneath, the dead man or person, we don't know who it may be, could be any of us. That is our journey.
Thank you. Ma'am.
And did he do complete paintings? Did he have assistance?
The question is...
Yeah.
The question is, did he do the whole painting or did he have assistance or a shop?
He was running for his life. He didn't... He would have had probably a young man working, an apprentice, working with the pigments, working... But we know that he never made a drawing. This he completed. It's the size would be higher than from the ground to the ceiling and from that wall to here. It's a colossal work. He did it in 3 months. And what we know is the only touches that he added to it to sort of frame what he was going to create was he would, as he was painting, he would sometimes turn the back of his brush and just make an indentation. This will be where Samson will be. And so, again, all the expert, everybody has their own point of view, but no one knows, quite honestly, no one knows. I'll take one more question.
Yes?
Yes? Okay. Oh, the acts of mercy are feed. I would.
It's much better if you look for them and try to. It's much more rewarding. I think Terence can mention the word, the acts of mercy.
Yes, the acts of mercy are feeding the hungry, give water to the thirsty, give care to the sick. Give shelter to the homeless or the pilgrim, to give a clothing to the naked, to bury the dead. And did I leave one out? Visit the prisoners. So for instance, as Pelle said, on the right you see two acts being performed. She is both feeding her father, but she's also visiting the prisoner.
If you want
yes.
a counting of the painting, I
thank you.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. This is the missing figure. Shown
14,
by the economy, just in
that's
here.
Right.
And down below.
15,
six, and then
and 16.
Yes.
Okay.
16.
Thank you.
But you can.
Thank you all very much.